Hey folks, it's Ray at DCRainmaker.com here, and today we are complete long-term in-depth review of the new Wahoo POWRLINK Zero pedals. Now these are Speedplay-based pedals and the first Speedplay-based power meter we've seen on the market. Of course, Wahoo bought Speedplay, the entire company and brand, about 2.5 years ago. And in fact, last spring, they announced the fact they're going to create a power meter pedal based on Speedplay, though they had intended on releasing that last summer. But nonetheless, here we are now, and it's finally starting shipping as of today. Now, okay, as I alluded to, this is a long-term review, because I've actually been using these on and off since last spring, but pretty consistently since this past fall, so like 6 months or so now of pretty much nonstop usage, pounding the crap out of these. As you can see right here, they are not clean or brand new looking, though I do have another pair of brand new ones right over there. But in terms of actual usage, these things have the battle scars to prove it. Now, before we get into that, let's talk some quick tech specs. Put it up on the screen right there. The first one is that there are two different models of the POWRLINK Zeros. There's a dual-sided one for $999, and there is a single-sided version for $649. Wahoo says down the road they will introduce a upgrade pedal option that then turns your single-sided unit into a dual-sided unit. If you do buy the single-sided unit, you get a dummy pedal, so you do get a right-sided pedal that has no electronics in it versus the left-sided pedal has electronics in it. In this case, I've been testing the dual-sided version here, which is a $999 one. Okay, so the dual-sided version here has claimed accuracy of plus or minus 1%. It's also got active temperature compensation in it, which means that if you go up a mountain over the course of many, many hours and back down a mountain, it'll go ahead and track that temperature correctly through that entire range so that the accuracy is also correct. It has an auto zero capability. It also has the ability for you to manual zero offset if you'd like to. It has connectivity in both Amp Plus and Bluetooth Smart, so it'll broadcast your power balance if it's a dual-sided version, as well as your cadence over both Amp Plus and Bluetooth Smart. It's multi-channel Bluetooth Smart as well, so you can connect multiple devices to it. It does not, however, do any sort of cycling dynamics, nor any sort of pedal smoothness or torque effectiveness. We'll get into that later on, but in a sense, Wahoo says they don't find any value in that, so that's not there today. It has two rechargeable battery pods. You can see these little pods right there. Those are the battery pods, and we'll talk about those a little bit later on. They get about 75 hours of battery life per pod. That seems about right in terms of what I'm getting. And it takes about 90 minutes to 2 hours to go ahead and charge up. Now, these pedals here are based on the Speedplay Zero pedals. So this one right there, and if we grab the correct one, I think this is the correct one, you can see they're very, very similar, but not exactly the same. The power meter is 1 millimeter longer, so it should tiny bit longer than the existing one. So that's why when you buy the single-sided version, you'll get that dummy pedal as well, so that the spindle lengths are exactly the same on both of them. Now, the weight of the pedal itself is 138 grams. Let's just grab this right there, pop it on. There we go, and boop. There we go, get that shadow out of the way. 137, 138 grams right there. Compared to the original Speedplay Zero, the Wahoo version anyways, at 110 grams right there. So obviously the pod here is adding to that weight. Now in this pod, it is electronics. So you have not just the battery, but also electronics that transmit out over Amp Plus and Bluetooth Smart. Next up, here's a bunch of random stats I know people love. First up, Q factor. You can see that right now on the screen. It's at 55 millimeters, 1 millimeter bigger than the original Speedplay Zeros, the Wahoo Speedplay Zeros anyways. You can see that's pretty much within 1 millimeter of everyone else in this ballpark right here, except for, of course, the Shimano version of the Favero Asioma pedals, which is definitely quite a bit longer. While we're at it, here is your stack heights on this side, and then on this side over here are your cornering factors, cornering angles, not factors, cornering angles. So I measure this by putting a phone on the bike and then tilting the bike until it hits the ground. And keep in mind, this is for my particular bike, in my case with 175 millimeter crank arm, so a slight bit longer, which means you're gonna get a little bit less cornering angle than if you have a 172 or 170 millimeter crank arm. Okay, and a quick note before we get too much further. If you are finding this video interesting and useful, go ahead and whack that like button at the bottom there. It really does help out this video and the channel quite a bit. Okay, so with all that said, let's talk about what's in the box itself. The first thing when you crack that open, I love the Wahoo box designs. They're just so well done, is that you do see the pedals sitting on top there. This will be the shiniest and prettiest they will ever look. Once you take them out, below that is the tray of all the mounting hardware. There is like 98 pieces of mounting hardware that are required for Speedplay pedals. It's kind of a mess, and by kind of mean it's totally a mess. But once you get it done like 3 or 4 times, you'll start to be getting good at it. I've done it probably like 5 or 6 times now, and I'm getting reasonably good at it. Just be really careful when you're putting all these things together that you do have the correct sides lined up on the correct feet, because if you got them on the wrong feet, it'll be all a big mess. You'll have to redo it again. So just keep that in mind. But once you got it good to go, you're good to go. Now, the easiest part of this whole thing is actually installing the pedals, not this pedal, the pedals themselves. So all you need to do is take the pedal itself, grab yourself one of your hex wrenches. Inside the bag, there is a small washer like this. In general, you will use a washer for most crank arms. The key thing you want to ensure is that when you put it into the crank arm, the threads all the way, that this paw does not touch the crank arm itself in any way, shape, or form. If it touches, that's bad. So the majority of the time, you'll probably use a washer like this to go ahead and create a bit of a space there so that it does not touch that crank arm. If it touches the crank arm, it'll go ahead and crack something in this pod eventually. So just don't do that. But that whole process takes all of like a minute or so to put those on there. And then at that point, you want to do a couple sprints. And the reason you want to do sprints is to really bed this into that crank arm nice and tight. So do like 3 to 4 high intensity sprints, ideally on a smart trainer or any sort of trainer at all for that matter. Just as like a general life practice, when I first install any pedals on any bike, I always like to do a couple sprints on a trainer just in case something goes wrong. It's not my face into the pavement, it's my face into like the couch or something like that. So once that's done, you go ahead and do a calibration, or technically called a zero offset. And you can do that from either your bike computer or from the Wahoo app. And speaking of which, since we have not yet paired up the Wahoo app, we will do that now. Go ahead and open up the Wahoo app itself and then go into the sensors menu. And then from there, add a new sensor. In this case, we're gonna choose the Wahoo PowerLink option. It'll go ahead and find those pedals. We're gonna set our crank length. Setting the crank length is incredibly important here. It ensures accuracy. If your crank length is set incorrectly, your power meter will not be accurate. And the same thing is then true on your bike computer. So whether you have a Wahoo or a Garmin or whatever it may be, it's also gonna have a spot when you pair it up there for your crank length. So now's a good time to add that. So in this case, we're gonna go ahead onto our bike computer. We'll go ahead and tell it we're gonna add and search for a new sensor. And then from there, it'll go ahead and find these power meters. You save that and then you can give it a name if you want to. And again, you'll see the option to set that crank length right there. And now we're done. It's as simple as that. Now we go out and ride. Now, when you're out riding, you're gonna get 3 metrics, as I mentioned earlier on from this. You will get total power, so the instantaneous power at that point in time. You will go ahead and get your power balance, so the balance between the left side and the right side, like this, as you're pedaling along. And then you'll go ahead and also get your cadence. There are other metrics that can come from that from power standpoint that the head unit or the bike computer will actually calculate. For example, 30-second power or your normalized power, all these different things. As I mentioned earlier, they do not send any sort of psychodynamics or pedal smoothness or torque effectiveness or anything in that range at all from these pedals to, well, anything on either Amp Plus or Bluetooth Smart. And in talking to Wahoo, they essentially said, well, actually not essentially, they said, and I quote, it's useless. And they're not entirely wrong. And their point in this longer conversation was that the data that's sent out today from those other pedaling systems, namely Garmin, their Vector and Rally, as well as the Favero Osteoma pedals, but ultimately all the data dynamics don't yet have a clear purpose. They're geeky, they're fun to look at, but when it comes to like a scientifically backed thing, there's nothing there today that supports any of these metrics and how to use them to get faster in training or racing. That's something I've talked about for probably more than half a decade now, that eventually I'd hope we would have seen that, and now half a decade or so later, we still haven't seen any data there. Now, setting all that aside for a second here, when I'm out on the road, I'm generally pretty happy with this pedals once I'm clipped in. Now, one of the strengths of the Speedplay platform or ecosystem is the idea that you can clip in on both sides, right? So the pedal can be either direction, and you just clip in and you're good to go. But now I say in theory, because in practice, I don't really have that problem either. If I look at other pedals like this one right here, you'll see it's bottom weighted. So that means that it automatically goes down the bottom every single time. So I don't really ever get a situation like this because of course it flips down to the bottom. Versus the Speedplay pedals you can see right here actually just stay put. So I end up plenty of situations where I go like this and then you gotta snip in or snap in. It's just not as good as I think people say it is. So for me, I'm not really a huge fan of the Speedplay pedal design myself. I thought, you know, after about a year of using Speedplay pedals to test, I started last spring before the power meter side and started using the zeros and whatnot. And it's not really my cup of tea. I just find that the number of times I go to clip on this, someone described it as like mashing a bug. You have to like really kind of go like this to get in there. And that's true. And to me, that just seems sort of silly, but that's just me. But you do you. As long as you love Speedplays, these are probably the pedals for you. Now, I will say that the cleats as well as the pedals are pretty darn durable. I went on a ride back in December that the ride turned into hiking over lava rocks for an hour and a half in my cleats, and also sections where I was trying to ride it, clunking into rocks with all this kind of stuff, and that's where some bloody scratches come from. And the cleats worked just fine. Once I got to the top of that entire climb, umpteen kilometers later of hiking and like cross training and stuff, then I just clipped in, I was good to go. The same thing happened a few weeks later when I had to go rescue
some drones out in a cow pasture, but first I had to cross a canal in mud. And again, the cleats and the pedals were just fine after that. The pedals didn't go for the swim, but the cleats most definitely did. Now, the cleats were then full of mud, and the mud was a bit hard to get out of those compared to getting mud out of other cleat types. But again, durability-wise, that lasted another 3 or 4 weeks before finally the cleats like gave out on life and I had to swap them out. But overall, the cleats are at least durable. And again, the pedals themselves have lasted despite all of my attempts to kill them. Now, lastly, before we get into the accuracy side of things, we have the battery connector. It's got a rechargeable battery, as I mentioned earlier, 75 hours per charge. Now it has a nice little USB-C adapter on the back of it there, so you can pop it into any USB-C cable you want to. It's also handy because if you can find like an extra one of those, you can just stick it in your saddlebag. So if you're traveling, you know you always have that charging clip with you, even if you forget the night before while you're packing your bike. It's just in your saddlebag, just that tiny little piece, and you stick it in any USB-C connector and you're good to go. Okay, so with that, let's dive into the accuracy. So in this case, I'm pulling up the DC Rainmaker Analyzer. I've linked that below there if you haven't seen that before. You can create your own sets if you want to with this. And I've been comparing against a lot of different things over quite a long time period. So different trainers, different power meters, etc. But I'm mostly gonna focus on data from the last like month and a half or so, basically the final firmware essentially. So the first one we're gonna look at right here is a very simple erg workout on trainer road. So in this case, it's also on the new Wahoo Roller. If you haven't seen that video, it's up in the corner there. And this is compared against a Cork D0 power meter and a PowerChap G3 power meter on the wheel hub there. And as you can see, it is spot on this. Now you see some variations in the power because the fact that the roller isn't like super good at holding power, but the actual accuracy between these units is just a couple watts across the board. It's astounding. The next set I have, another erg workout. This is like a bunch of 30 by 30s. It's a lot of 30 by 30s, in fact. And this is on the Expedo Apex Pro trainer. And that trainer is not at all very accurate. As you can see right there, that line way below the Cork and the Wahoo units, but the Wahoo and the Cork align pretty much perfectly across this and respond perfectly across these major shifts from, you know, 140 or so watts all the way up to 400 watts for each single set, over and over and over and over again, spot on there. The next one you have is a Zwift race from earlier on this week. And racing is really fun on Zwift from a power meter accuracy standpoint, because you get these constant surges back and forth where power meters have to like keep up with that. And then you get these actual sprints in there. So anyways, the point there being though, that these are all like identical. Like it's scary how close these are, perhaps even too close to be honest. Theoretically speaking, the trainer and then the PowerTap G3 should be the lowest. Then from there, the Quark. And then from there, the Wahoo PowerLink Plus, because in terms of the way you expend power, not by much, but like by maybe 0.5% or so. But these are all like within 1% across the board. So I'm not gonna complain too much about that, but it's scary accurate, including like, for example, the sprint right here. And if I look at the mean max power across that entire set, I mean, these are almost identical. Anyways, let's head outside. This first one here is a route that I did just last week. And this is mostly road, but also a bit of gravel. You can see this little gravel section right here with these cows. And gravel's great because it's a good way to test the accelerometer stuff in there. And you can see here, it's a bit jumpy looking in terms of all three of these because it's an outdoor ride. But then if I zoom in, this is the gravel section. It's flawless right there. And then also some surges I did later on, these, you know, up to 500-600 watts kind of over and over again. Everything was perfectly aligned. And the same goes for the mean max. Very, very, very close for an outdoor ride. I mean, there's nothing really to complain about here. So let's jump like something even harder. This is a 7-hour ride I did up the side of volcano and back down again. And this is great because I went through many different climate zones over the course of this day from morning until 6 p.m. at night or so by the time I finished up. And so you see these shifts in temperature down in the ocean, up in the trees, then up again in the lava fields, yet we don't see it in the data. It's spot on. Now, we'll note there's one little drop there you see right in the middle where the green drops to the bottom. And that's because the night before I upgraded the firmware to the final firmware on these. And when I did that, one of the pedals failed the upgrade and I didn't realize it, didn't catch up to the next day. So there's some sort of negotiation issue there. But in terms of the accuracy for the rest of the ride, it was like spot on, really, really good. And you can see that in the mean max graph there, a little bit of variance towards the left-hand side of that chart, partially because of that dropout. But that's not something you would see in the production units. That was just, again, having two different versions of software on the same pedals can introduce some quirks there. And if we look at the cadence as well on this, like it's spot on perfect. Some slight differences on the PowerTap G3, of course, because that's estimated cadence, but between the Quark and the PowerLink, they're perfectly the same. Overall though, like if I look at months and months and months of data here, everything is spot on. It's perfect in terms of where I want it to be, which is ultimately the same, to be fair, of like all of these things. All these pedal-based power meters, the ones made in the last couple of years, are spot on from an accuracy standpoint. Just not something I'm seeing from these particular brands at this point in time, which is great, which means you have choices. And of course, then this gets into the final section. Would I recommend the POWRLINK Zero? And yeah, simply put, I have no problems recommending it, assuming it's the cleat type you want. Meaning that if you want a Speedplay based power meter, this is your only option, to be honest. So if that's your case, you'll have no regrets buying this, I don't think, at this point in time. Now, if you don't care about what pedal type you have, then you've got the whole field kind of in front of you. You can go the Garmin side and get, you know, three different power meter pedal types out of that, SPD, SPDSL, as well as Lokio, or you can go the SRM side and get the SPD pedals, or you can go the Favero Asioma side and get the Lokio or SPDSL pedals, or even the SPDs if you do the kind of funky hack thing there. The point is you have lots of choices, and these here are all good choices. Like, there's no wrong answer there, especially with the battery upgrades in the newer SRM X series pedals. They're pretty solid. That gets us in the same general range as most of these other rechargeable units. Of course, there's other factors to consider, namely price, for example. Favero's on the cheaper end, though there's no reason for it to be. It's an extremely accurate pedal, extremely solid. A lot of people super happy with it. Garmin tends to be in the upper end, probably because of the fact that you can swap so easily between the different pedal types if you want to move from bike to bike. SRM tends to be on the middle upper end as well, but that's all stuff you can decide whether or not each of those features is worth the extra cost to you. And of course, I've also got a video coming up that's going to compare all these power meter pedals side by side and kind of all the nuanced details between them. So stay tuned for that. And again, if you found this video interesting or useful, go ahead and whack that like button at the bottom there or hit subscribe for plenty more sports technology goodness. With that, have a good one.